friends, how are you? Welcome on board our 40 days program. We call it a new life. New life being we're going to work on understanding what we're doing. Sorry friends, we actually started thinking that we're live, but we were not. So now we're live on Instagram and live on Facebook. So welcome aboard the 40 days program, starting a new life. What is new life all about? We're working with this book, The Purpose Driven Life, and it's by Rick Warren. The question is, what on earth am I here for? Today is actually day 15 in our books, and it's chapter 15. What happened? We skipped a few days, I think 2 days. We took a break because a lot was going on and it was getting very intense and a lot of work happening, and then we had to sit down and read and review the chapters and then come to you. So we were just literally drained. And we needed to just take a little break from it all. So we're back on track and we'll see how far we'll go again before we take another break. Because 40 days is quite a bit of a long time. And we want to make it as productive as possible. We don't want it to just be just churning out something that's not making sense. So while we took the break, again, I personally took time to understand what I'm doing and make sense of it. And like we always say, we want you to chat with us. We want you to tell us what you're feeling about this. We want to hear from you if it's making any sense, if it's contributing to actually giving you this new life that we're hoping to have. For me, a lot has happened. For me, it's definitely given me a new life. And this was really my dream for taking it on. So let me read to you some of the reviews I've got out of it before we go into our chapter 15. So based on the previous chapters that we've done, things come back to me to just talk about it, like, is this what this meant? Okay, this is what it means, and this is what you should get out of this statement or this chapter or this message. And these are some of the messages that I've got, and I call it lessons of life. So number one says, naturally, we just ask, how much pleasure am I getting out of life? That's what we just normally ask. But the book is reminding us that we should rather ask, how much pleasure is God getting out of my life? Now, the minute you turn that question around, you find that some of the things that you were worried about and chasing and wanting to do changes. How much pleasure is God getting out of me? And so, it helps me to now see how I'm contributing to life and not so much what life should be giving me. And this program is one of them. I'm sharing this with you, and this is God's way of flowing through me, which is one of the things we talked about. So number two is, what is your metaphor of life? Again, we read one of the chapters where he's asking us, what is your metaphor of life? Because your metaphor of life is what dictates your life. And some examples I picked out were, you know, you work so hard, so that's because that's what you think life should be. Remember, we are recording this for YouTube, so if you miss out on the live programs, you know, the Facebook Live and the Instagram Live, just go on YouTube and follow it. We've done it daily, like day by day. So your metaphor of life dictates how you live. What work hard? You work too hard. If you work too hard, that's because that's how you see life. Do you party too hard? Do you have fun too much? Do you spend a lot of money just to keep having fun? That's your understanding of what life should be. Do you spend all your time in education? And I know so many people who never stop. They finish the first degree, they're going for masters. After masters, they're going to their PhD or doctorate program, and it just goes on and on. And when they finish that one, they're finding another area of life and they want to just carry on training and training and training, and you never really put that into use. So that's their metaphor of life. Do you travel a lot? There are people who all they want to do is just travel. They don't want to sit in one place. And so whatever you are thinking about is what you become. But God's way of seeing our life is completely different from how we see it. And the chapters were like, life is a test, where we talked about the way God tests us with so many things. So some of the experiences we have, which may be really difficult, it's just a test to see how we respond to it. And then he says life is a trust, and that's about how all the major knowledge and skills and information we get, God is trusting us with that, and he wants us to share it with the rest of the world. Again, this is one of my way of using his trust to his advantage. So we are all equipped with multitude of skills and talents and experiences and knowledges. And this is in order for us to use it to enrich the world and give our God pleasure. So that's what I just mentioned about how God trusts us with all these things, and he wants us to use it to his pleasure. Because we should always remember that our life here is actually for God's pleasure, not for our pleasure. The other thing we picked up again was, we are not expected to get too comfortable in this world, as this is not the end of our life or our journey. And this is a very good one to pick on, because nobody is lasting in this world forever. You know, the Bible even says it, that we may last 70 or 80 years. And that's when our body can carry us. And you can relate to that, because some of us, all kinds of illnesses come, all kinds of things happen to us. And once they start to happen, what then do we get? The body struggles. And once the body cannot handle it, it gives up. Now, the minute the body gives up, our spirit disappears, because the spirit cannot live on this earth without the body. So that's why, on the other hand, we need to take that extra care to look after our body, because it is the house in which the spirit lives in. But on the other hand, we also are told that the reason life is not so exciting all the time, which one of the chapters said is the pendulum of life. So from one time it flings to the other side, and another time it flings to the other side. And there's another book I read which was talking about peaks and valleys of lives. It's all about the fact that it will not always stay on this straight line. There are times things will be really great and you're so excited, and there are times when things will dip down and you're really, really down. And times like that, these are just, again, the test, because how do you carry it? How do you cope through it? And for me, that was one of the times that actually made me pick up this book, because I was in that place where things were really, really dragging me, draining me down. I was under all kinds of pressure. And I just decided, when I remember that I had that book, I said, I really want to know what my purpose is in life. And that's why I decided to pick the book. Picking the book, then a voice just said, well, if you're feeling this way, so many other people are feeling this way as well. Why don't you share the book with them? And that's why we decided to go on this 40-day journey. So we're not expected to get too comfortable is one of the reasons it gives, that not everybody has it. Nobody has it all. Surprisingly enough, that really touched me. Was like, wow, if you think yours is bad, wait until you hear the other person's story. Wait until you hear the other person's story. And the story carries on in different forms. While somebody may be struggling with financial issues, financial difficulties, debts, and all kinds of things happening, another person may be struggling with ill health. Another person may be struggling with, they might have all the money in the world and their children are absolutely useless. So there's a lot of things going on, and no one person has it all. That just explains why none of us are expected to be too close, feel too comfortable in this world. Number five was, God flows through us, so we should allow him to use us to express his desires for the world. Be a good vessel to carry God's message. Don't be selfish. So it's all about, again, we've talked about it. God has trusted us with all this knowledge, all these talents. You see, somebody will be so great at doing something with their hands, and the other person has no clue what to do with their hands and probably is better with the brain. Or the other person has an amazing voice and the other person can run Usain Bolt 10 minutes or 10 seconds is there. And some people are great at football. They could score a million goals like Lionel Messi. So it just carries on and carries on. Everybody is gifted with different things. And that's how God wants it to be. So it's important we start understanding all these various lessons, because that's what makes our world really unique. And he says we should do it all in God's glory, whatever we are doing. So whatever this talent you found yourself great at, whatever this skill is that you know how to do well, do it in God's glory. He's not saying you should stop what you're doing. And one of the statements he says is, when anything created fulfills its purpose, it brings God glory. So you being able to fulfill your purpose is aimed at giving God glory. Because he put that purpose in your hands. He put that trust in your hands with these skills. And it's these skills, when you can use it, or, you know, ability to do something, or talent, or information, or experience. Once you can do any of that, God is quite happy with you. The next one was, life is a temporary assignment. So no matter who you are, no one is made to last forever. That's another big one. We mentioned it earlier too. We do not own this earth. We all come and go. Therefore, do not get too attached or comfortable with life. This is why no one has it all. There's always something missing. A sign for you not to become too complacent. It has been planned that way. Naked you come, naked you return. Or we take nothing with us because we came with nothing. So, a big message. It is a temporary assignment. So, 70 years, 80 years, 100 years, tops, we're gone. So why then do we allow the stress to drag us down? I mean, I remember one of the last episodes we had, and somebody asked the question, how do you handle stress? How do you handle stress? This is one of the reasons, or one of the things you can remind yourself. Life is temporary, so why do you take on this stress? It's not worth the trouble. We've talked about life is a test, because we are constantly experiencing situations in our life. They are like stormy weather. And these are a series of crosses for us to bear. I call it carrying the cross of life. Again, you know, this Sunday past was this Palm Sunday. And we went to church, and one of the big things that was happening was obviously Palm Sunday. So we read through the whole experience Jesus had before he got taken to the cross. And then the people were spitting at him, throwing things at him, and, you know, leering at him and calling him names and all kinds of things. Jesus had no sin. He did nothing wrong. But he had to go through all of that because of us humans. We had hurt God so much, and he needed something for us to go through, for him to feel sorry for us again and forgive us. So we always have to go through something on this earth. So while we were saying, yes, the ups and downs of life, I just feel that somehow, when we go through these difficult times, we should remember what Jesus went through for us. That really touched me. Someone who had no sin, but had to go through human form and experience all this pain. So if you can relate to that, if you can relate to the pain that Jesus went through, I was telling somebody yesterday, then I don't see what kind of pain we are going through that could be that bad. So it's for us to be strong to weather through it. Jesus went through it for us. So it's for you, whatever the situation is, whatever the stress is, to be strong enough to go through it. And that's why I call it carrying the cross of life. So the cross of life means you have to be strong, whatever the situation is, to overcome it. Because it is a test. It is a necessity that we must all go through. So how do we weather this storm? How do we overcome this challenge of bearing our own cross? And I just explained what Jesus went through. So it is mandatory for us all to pass through tests and series of tests in life. Go to God and ask for help. It is a test for you to overcome, and God wants us to pass this test. So the last thing was, life is a trust. Not really the last thing, there's more. Life is a trust. God has entrusted us with so many different gifts, which I talked about earlier, so I won't mention that one again. We are unique for God's pleasure. This is a really great one, because there is no need for anybody to feel superior over anybody or feel inferior with anybody. Why? Because God created us differently. All you have to do is use your unique gifts for God's glory and pleasure. This knowledge explains why there is no need for jealousy, there is no need for envy, there is no need for pride, there is no need for arrogance, there is no need for superiority or inferiority. You, whoever you are, as long as you've been created by God, you bring pleasure to God by being yourself and not by trying to be anyone else. If you find anything we're talking about so far is making sense, please feel free to give us a shout out. We're excited to be here with you. So this should remind us, for anything, when anything created fulfills its purpose, it brings pleasure to God. This should remind us why we do not need stress in our life. We talked about that. Just be yourself and walk with God for directions. This knowledge has helped me to be a lot freer and relaxed. Because obviously, if you know that you bring pleasure to God because He created you uniquely. Remember, we talked about how we all have different skills and different talents and different experiences. It is all for the pleasure of God. And when I look at this, it reminds me of the flower in the garden and the birds in the sky and the animals in the forest. Every one of them is different and they all coexist. So why then do we humans think that we have to feel superior over the other and have this pride and this arrogance and all of that? This book has clearly energized me to understand the fact that I am unique. I am different. Whatever I possess, they are the things that God put in me. And that's the same feeling I want you to have. You are unique, you are different, you are special. Whatever it is you possess are the things that God put in you. And the whole idea was to bring Him pleasure. So He never made any of us to be the other. There was no mistake. If you find you're black, if you find you're white, if you find you're whatever color you're made of, that's the way God wanted it. Whatever hairstyle you have, that's the way God wanted it. Whatever makes you happy, that's the way God wanted it. So be happy whichever way you find yourself. And be proud of who you are and enjoy your gifts and time here on earth. Make the best of it. And that's what we're calling a new life. Because it's a new understanding. The knowledge that you are uniquely gifted. Okay, so I'm going to carry on now to go to the chapter that we actually are meant to be looking at today, and that's chapter 15. So all the little bits I read about were just my personal insight into it, and for us to really know that, yes, this program is really giving us something to think about, really giving us something to relax our mind, express our thoughts, encourage us to understand things that have been hidden away from us. Because you sit there and you're just worrying yourself over nothing. Because that's what the world wants us to do. It wants us to worry. Constantly worrying over the most ridiculous things. But when we worry and we know that we're not made to last forever, then what's the point of it? We're meant to enjoy. We're meant to relax. We're meant to have fun. We're meant to release those talents and those gifts that God gave us. We're meant to use it to His pleasure. So that's the big message. Okay, so today our chapter says formed for God's family. We are formed for God's family. So God is the one who made all things, and all things are made for His glory. We've explained that several times. That's what this book reminds us all the time. He wanted to have many children share His glory. And this is in Hebrews chapter 2, verse 10. He says, see how very much our Heavenly Father loves us, for He allows us to be called His children, and we really are. And this is in 1 John chapter 3, verse 1. And this just reminded me, because somehow I happened to be busy today, and I was at the same time watching a movie, you know, The Lion King. And at this point, when the son had run away because his uncle had killed the dad, and he didn't know what to do with his life again. He just had to, because the uncle said, run, because you killed your dad. And he felt he was guilty. He felt he was the one who caused the dad's death. So he ran and left. And he was not prepared to go back home again. Somehow, one of these animals came to him and now reminded him who he was. And that really made me, it related to what we're doing with this program. He says, He lives in you. Now, he thought his dad was dead and he wasn't interested in going back home again. But he reminded him, He lives in you. So that just reflected, I reflected on that. God lives in us. And that's why we have to keep remembering that we are God's children and He lives in us. Now, the minute we remember that, we will not go wrong. because we can't go wrong with that. And he also told him, remember who you are. When he actually thought he saw a reflection of his dad and his dad was not talking to him, the dad said to him, remember who you are. You are my son. That just made me realize that that's who we are. We are God's children. And here he's talking about how he wanted to have many children share his glory. So we are God's children. Someone just wrote to us, she says, I'm mixed, should I get a perm? Good question. It's just that today we are actually working on personal development and working with God. But I would love to see what your hair looks like and see if you really do need a perm. Now, ironically, I don't encourage chemicals at all. I personally would rather you wear different hairs that's not yours in the texture you enjoy wearing than going to destroy your hair, because what happens, the chemicals actually eventually destroy your hair. So thank you for the question. Okay, so we're carrying on. So the first purpose is we wear plants for God's pleasure. So this is one of the ones we read before. And the second purpose is we were formed for God's family. So this is where we are. We're formed for God's family. God wants a family and he created you to be a part of it. That's where we are. He said in the Bible, God is building a family who will love him, honor him, and reign with him forever. And he says, the Bible says his unchanging plan has been to adopt us to his own family by bringing us to himself through Jesus Christ. And this gave him great pleasure. So you remember how we talked about when Jesus came down to go through the human experience and in the end was crucified and all of that for our sake. That's what God wanted. Because going through Jesus Christ, we became God's family. As God is love, he treasures relationships. So he wants us to be part of him at all times. His nature is rational, and he identifies himself in family terms, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. So the Trinity is God's relationship with himself. It's perfect plan, a pattern for relational harmony, and we should understand its implications. God has always existed in loving relationship to himself, so he has never been lonely. He didn't need a family, he desired one. So he designed a plan to create us and bring us into his family and share with us all that he has. Family gives God pleasure. The Bible says it was a happy day for him when he gave us our new lives through the truth of his word, and we became, as it were, the first children in his family. When we place our faith in Christ, God becomes our Father. We become his children. Other believers become our brothers and sisters, and the church becomes our spiritual family. And that's just the way God wants us to be. Someone just asked again, do we have classes in the U.S.? Yes, we usually have classes once in a while in the U.S. We haven't planned one right now. But yes, we are working on planning one soon. Thank you for the question. It says you are all children of God through faith in Christ Jesus. Our spiritual family is more important than our physical family because it lasts forever. So as a member of a family, which we all are, the Bible is telling us that our spiritual family, which is the family of God, is more important than our physical family. Another person asked a question again about braiding. Okay, thank you so much, all my beautiful friends. I love you all so much. This is the big secret now. We're planning eventually to have live programs on braiding where all the questions on braiding will come up and we will respond to all of them. But what we decided to do first was this 40-day program, which is to clear our understanding about life and how we can move forward in whatever else that we plan on doing. And in as much as I really love to share so much about braiding, We want us to be really, really more spiritually inclined so that whatever we take on, we know that God is supporting us and guiding us. So yes, a question came, what is the healthiest method of braiding? It would depend on what you're looking at. You remember all the braiding techniques, we call them protective hairstyles. So the only time braiding could go wrong is when you hold the hair too tight. And then what happens, you start losing hair. So what happens, that person may have pulled the hair too much from the follicles and then it starts coming out. Otherwise, braiding is generally quite healthy. The only one I think may be a bit too harsh for the hair sometimes is when you hold cornrows too tight. So I'm not going to say anyone is bad. Only if you hold the cornrows too tight, then it becomes a problem. Otherwise, all braiding techniques are quite okay. Okay, thank you so much. So we're carrying on with our spiritual journey. Our spiritual family is more important than our physical family because it lasts forever. Our physical family on the earth are wonderful gifts from God, but they are temporary. And why? Because we are fragile and we are often broken, sometimes by divorce. So you see a man and a woman will come together, get married, have children, and the next thing they divorce. And then the children get so confused. Sometimes it's because of distance. So a child will move on to another state, another country. A dad may move on to another country, a mom may move on to another country, and this creates distance. And when this happens, the family starts to disintegrate. Sometimes we grow old, and then of course, eventually, death happens. So this is what happens with the physical family. And so he's trying to remind us that the physical family does not last forever. But the family that lasts forever is this God's family, and this is the spiritual family. So on the other hand, our spiritual family relationship with other believers continues through our eternity. And this is a much stronger union, a more permanent bond than blood relationships. And he gave an example. Whenever Paul stops to consider God's eternal purpose for us, he goes into praise. He says, when I think of the wisdom and scope of his plan, this is Paul now talking about God, I fall down on my knee and I pray for the Father of all the great family of God. Some of them already in heaven and some down here on earth. So this is Paul. Whenever he thinks of God's family, he gets so excited because he knows that this family is forever and is eternal. So he now goes further to say, what is the benefit of being in God's family? The moment you were spiritually born into God's family, you were given some astounding birthday gifts. The family name, the family likeness, the family privileges, family intimate access, and family inheritance. So these are all the things that God promised you. So since you are his child, everything he has belongs to you. Now this is a big message for all of us. So you remember the message I mentioned where, remember who you are. He lives in you. Once you remind yourself that you are God's child and God lives in you, I think you know how they say it, the sky is not the limit. Because anything that you ever think of doing, as long as you're God's child, it's possible. And this is how God planned it, for us to completely have eternity in him. And since you are his child, everything God has belongs to you. The New Testament gives great emphasis to our rich inheritance. So this is our inheritance from God. It tells us, my God will meet all your needs according to his glorious riches in Christ Jesus. Now think about the world and everything there is in it. It all belongs to God. So for as long as you belong to this God's family, everything here on earth belongs to you. And plus, eternal ones, the ones we haven't even seen. As children of God, we get to share in the family fortune. Here on earth, we are given the riches of his grace. The grace of God is with us at all times. We are given the riches of his patience. We are given glory from God. We are given wisdom. Now, wisdom is one of those greatest ones that you can ever think about. We are given power. And we are given mercy. These are all amazing gifts that God has given to us. In eternity, we will inherit more. Apart from all these ones we've talked about, when we go into eternity, we inherit more. But of course, for most of us here, we don't even want to think that far. We're just thinking about here and now that we are. And Paul said, I want you to realize what a rich and glorious inheritance he has given to his people. So for as long as you belong to God's family, everything here belongs to you. The Bible says, since you are his child, everything he has belongs to you. And so we're trying to explain what the inheritance includes. You will be with God forever. So that's one of the things God promised us. Be changed to be like Jesus Christ. You're freed from all pain, debt, and suffering. Because remember, here on earth, we've been told that for the fact that this is not eternity, we cannot continue to feel too comfortable here. And this is why most of these pains and sufferings happen to us. But when we go to eternity with Jesus, we will be freed from pain. We will be freed from death, which is something that every human being goes through. So when all of that happens, when eternity happens, all of this will disappear. We will be rewarded and reassigned positions of service with God. We will get to share in Jesus Christ's glory. So what an inheritance. We are far richer than we realize. And the Bible says, God has reserved a priceless inheritance for his children. It is kept in heaven for us, pure and undefiled, beyond the reach of change and decay. So here on earth, no matter what we think we have, things happen to it. Things happen to it. You could lose it all in one day. Which, remember the story we read about Job, where he lost everything in one day. That's what happens here on earth. This means our eternal inheritance is priceless, is pure, is permanent, and is protected. He says no one can take it from us once we get there. It can't be destroyed by war. And so we live in a world where there's constant war going on. It cannot be destroyed by poor economy. We live in these countries where economy is such an issue. Every time you put the news on, oh, and the economy is gone down this way and it's gone down that way, you hear people losing jobs and there's no job anywhere, and suddenly you are in debt because there's no money anywhere. We will not be bothered by natural disasters, because then God is in control. You see, this eternal inheritance and not retirement is what we should be looking forward to and working towards. So generally for us humans, when you're working anywhere, the most important thing you're thinking about is your retirement. Oh, I'm going to be retired soon. I'm getting to 65. I'm getting to 60. I'm getting to 70. And so your worry is your retirement and what you're going to get out of it. But it says in eternity, you don't have to worry about all of that. And Paul said, whatever you do, work at it with all your heart as working for the Lord, not for men, since you know that you will receive an inheritance from the Lord as a reward. So whatever we're doing on this earth, we should work at it really well. We should work not for men, but we should work for God, since we know that we will receive inheritance from him as a reward. See, remember we said God sees us, God gives us trust. Whatever he's given us is a trust from him. Don't remind us that he's trusting us with these talents, with these skills, with this knowledge. So whatever you're using these things for, use it to God's glory. Because when you work for God, be sure that you are going to gain an inheritance. This inheritance that we're talking about. Because you're going to get a reward out of it. It says retirement is a short-sighted goal. Remember we just said when people get to 60, get to 70, get to 80. No countries ever talked about 80. 60, 70, maybe 75 sometimes I'm hearing. Retirement is short-sighted. It's short-sighted. So this is what we should be thinking about. What we should be aiming for is eternity. And so we should be living for eternity. Then he explains again that when we walk in God's family, baptism is the next big thing for us. Because when we get baptized, that means we have now been officially welcomed in God's family. And he's reminding us in the book that we should aim to make sure we're baptized. And that's for us Christians. So, the next one is life's greatest privilege. Bible says, Jesus and the people he makes holy all belong to the same family. That is why he isn't ashamed to call them his brothers and his sisters. So, when you are part of Jesus Christ, he calls you his family. And let this amazing truth sink in, because we are part of God's family, and because Jesus makes us holy, God is proud of us. Jesus makes us holy, God is proud of us. And so the word of Jesus are unmistakable. Jesus pointed to his disciple and said, "These are my mother and brothers. Anyone who does the will of my Father in heaven is my brother and my sister and my mother." Now, this is one of my favorite quotes from Jesus Christ. Because when you listen to God's words and you obey his commands, he says you are his brother, you are his sister, you are his mother. And I've said this over and over, especially with Braiding. Lots of people out there are struggling to find, you know, to make ends meet. But my advice to most people is, you have two hands. You can start your business with your hands. And this is where this book is coming really useful. We've been given talents. We've been given skills. We've been given experiences. We've been given knowledge. Now the talents I got, which was working with hair, I created an amazing program with this talent, working with hair. And this particular program is a 30 DVD program. Where once you put your hands down and study everything in this package, you are going to be so good at it. You're going to offer your service to people around you, and you're going to make money out of it. I have done that, and that's why I can talk about it. This was my way of sharing my knowledge with you. Rather, this is my way of sharing my knowledge with you. Because the talent that God gave me, when you use it for God's pleasure, God is happy with you. And I have not hidden my knowledge. I have not said, no, nobody come to me, I don't want to share it. I've not said, you know what, I'm the only one who knows how to use this skill, let me hide it. Come and buy my products. No. Come and buy my hair extension. Come and buy my wigs. Come and buy my... I didn't say that. I said, I want to share what I know with you. And that's why I created that program. So this is the way I feel I can share a bit of me with you. But of course, people who listen to me and do the things I'm talking about in that program, they achieve great results. And these are the people that I could happily call my brothers and my sisters, because you've been able to do something with the knowledge that I've shared with you. So that's the dream I have for you. And when Jesus is saying, if we listen to him and we respond to the things he's telling us, he calls us his brothers and his sisters. That makes me feel good. And I just wish you can listen and do the things I'm suggesting to you. Because I know it works. Okay. So, being included in God's family is the highest honor and the greatest privilege you will ever receive. Now, can you imagine how amazing this is? To be included in God's family, where you don't have to worry about what men think about you. For me, it has been an amazing experience so far, chapter 15. Whenever we feel unimportant, unloved, insecure, remember to whom you belong. You belong to God. Remember, like in the Lion King, remind yourself who you are. Remind yourself, he lives in you. Remind yourself that God walks through you. Remind yourself that God flows through you. Remind yourself that you are uniquely created and that you have potentials, you have powers, you have talents, you have skills, you have knowledge, you have experiences, you have information that other people don't have. Feel free to share them. Because a life that is fulfilled is the life that God loves. It's the life that makes God happy. He created you, and so he wants the best out of you. He wants you to further his creation. He wants you to further the world. And that's a big message coming out of this book. Because when you remember that, you're going to find that nothing touches you anymore. You're going to find that that stress will disappear. Because you're going to concentrate on those unique things that has made you different. Try not to be anybody else. Just try to be yourself. That knowledge that God appreciates you the way you are. That God wants you to remain the way he created you. That he doesn't want to mix you with anybody else. You shouldn't try to be another person. That knowledge is awesome. And that's the knowledge I want you to take with you today. So, this is where our chapter today ends. And I'm so happy that we've been able to do it. Again, I'm really excited about this program. Tomorrow we're going to be coming to you with chapter 16. But the big question, you know, normally when we finish, we ask the question. We say, how can I start treating other believers like members of my own family? How can I start treating other believers like members of my own family? And that's the big question. So remember, we always also go into meditation. Meditation. His unchanging plan has always been to adopt us into his own family by bringing us to himself through Jesus Christ. And this is, let me see the chapter where that came from. That came from Ephesians chapter 1, verse 5. His unchanging plan has always been to adopt us into his own family by bringing us to himself through Jesus Christ. Ephesians 1 verse 5. So I look forward to seeing you tomorrow, and God bless you eternally.